Right. Good morning, class. We're going to be talking about international conflict, chapter 5. This is from the PPAUS text. If you had problems earlier opening this text, one of the issues was that WordPress decided last week to sort of change their website a little and take off some of this content. So I've uploaded the PDF. You should have access to it. If you still can't upload the PDF on WebCampus, go through that process. Now, right now you're looking at PowerPoint. We're going to be doing it this way today, because I noticed that in the last video, it didn't come up at all. So as we're taking these steps, the quality will continue to increase. I just want you to continue to follow along. And so we're just gonna cover chapter 5, and then I'll probably have a separate video between now and next Tuesday that's not content related, but we'll explain a lot of these factors that we're looking at and maybe go back into that WebCampus window so you can see what I'm doing and what needs to be done next. For now, let's talk about international conflict. One of the parts about international conflict is we have different types of conflict and different types of war. So let's get right into that. So wars over time have been decreasing, and I want to use this language sort of very carefully. We've had a decrease in the number of wars and a decline in the intensity of those wars. So less deaths and less wars. However, one of the things that was being ignored was this idea of subnational conflict, right? If you have a genocide, if you have an ethnic conflict, if you have any of those things, they're actually on the rise after 1992, after the end of the Cold War, they have increased, although other types of wars have decreased. So states don't go to war as much, but you still have conflicts within a society, within a state. Most of the conflicts are in the global south. Now, part of that is because of the global north's high barriers to conflict, not just sort of all the combinations, right? France and Germany aren't going to go to war. There's a lot of interdependence, right? They're both part of the EU. They are both combined in their economics and their political sort of foundations now, but they've been part of the EU for some time. The other part is military. You will not see Canada and the US or the US and Mexico to go to war because their militaries are much larger, right? When you have a larger military, the cost of conflict and the cost of going through that process is less likely. Now, that being said, when you talk about the US specifically, it's going to war other places, but there's no risk of the US being invaded, right? So the military is behaving differently. Also, there are at least 6 or 7 countries that just won't go to war with each other because of the idea of weapons of mass destruction and this doctrine that's called mutually assured destruction, or MAD. So what happens in a mutually assured destruction process is if you try to blow up one country with weapons, they're going to blow you up, right? And so we all die in that process. That's why we always see nuclear weapons as a deterrence. The other part, right, sort of this Russian context that has always been considered, is why would the U.S. never invade Russia? Because if the U.S. invaded Russia and the U.S. military, which is a little more advanced in their fighter craft, a little more advanced in their mechanized infantry, right, if their tanks start to take ground in Russia, right, there is a belief that Russia would use its own atomic and nuclear weapons to blow up the conventional forces. That's called a preemptive strike, right? I don't want to lose this war, and I'm willing to use nuclear weapons on my own soil in order to keep you from taking over territory. So there are a lot of barriers that exist in the global north that don't exist in the global south. That doesn't mean you can't have subnational conflict in the global north, but you're not going to see states go to war with each other in the global north because of all of these barriers. So it's not necessarily right later. We hear some conflicts about why do some conflicts occur, and it seems like we're saying that certain cultures or certain religions or certain identities are more likely to go to war, and that's just not the case. There is no evidence that one religion or one ethnic group or one part of the world is more likely to go to war. There are other factors at play, and those really matter. All right, we need to have some very clear terms, right? This is all always important to me. It should be important to you. What am I saying, and how are we sharing our language, right? This is generative grammar. For those of you that talked about it before, we need to make our terms overlap so that we're very clear about a lot of this, and I'm going to adjust this a little so we can all see, and I can't go full screen. It's just kind of a problem with the capture method I'm using right now. So a state is a territory, right? The territory and the regime that exists. The regime is the rules about who can be in charge, right? Saddam Hussein, his family can only be in charge. The Assad regime, only a certain type of people, only Alawites, a certain type of religious group, and part of the Assad family can be in power. By Saudi Arabia, it's the Saud family. If you're in a democratic regime, we elect leaders, right? And hopefully you're in a democratic regime, anyone can get elected, right? You need money and name recognition, all these things, but anyone can get elected, and who's in charge can change. And that's what we mean by government. Government is who's in charge right now. And the United Kingdom does this very clearly. Whenever they have new elections, they have to form new government, usually a coalition of a number of parties, and they sort of start over with who's in charge. You have the same rules in place, and you have the same territory, but you have different elected officials, and sometimes that means the institutions will change. So a government is different from a regime, and a state has a regime and territory. We want to be clear about this. And these terms are defined very specifically for this course and for IR. So when you see American theorists, right, and when I say Americans, I don't mean people who are Americans, I mean people are talking about American government, they're talking about something different than what we're talking about in IR, and it's important when we're talking about international relations that we stay focused on these things that matter to us. All right. Sorry, I know I'm jumping around a bit, I just want to make sure. So there are a couple of different types of war as we're moving through this process. The first is hegemonic war. Hegemonic war means I want to change the whole system. I want to completely replace or remove any existing laws or norms in our system and replace them all. This is the clear example of World War II, right? The Axis powers lose, the winners, right, ostensibly Russia or the Soviet Union, United States, they start making a lot of rules. You see the United Nations come about. You see all of these doctrines about who has certain rights and nationality, right, what it means to be a citizen comes up, the Refugee Council, right, the High Commissioner of Refugees, all of these rules start coming into play after that. That's a hegemonic war where the international system changes significantly. It is likely, it is very, very unlikely that that can occur again. For the US and sort of the Western European states and China and Russia to no longer be part of this sort of rules-making system, right, the permanent five that you have on the UN Council, Security Council, you would have to have such a devastation of conflict that it would probably wipe out the human race. So a hegemonic war isn't really possible in the way that we think about it in the past, right? You can't have a World War III without killing the majority of the population, right? Because of all these weapons of mass destruction that we have, biological, nuclear, right? All of these weapons would just kill off most of the population. The next thing is total war. And we want to use this term very carefully because total war, it means two different things depending on what context you're talking about. In the text, when they're talking about total war, they just mean one state trying to take over another state. Right, this is Germany expanding, this is Napoleon expanding, this is I want your territory to be part of my country now and I'm going to take over. This is not colonialism. Colonialism is not I want your territory, it's I want the resource of your territory. And we know the difference because what will typically happen during the colonial period is that a state like the UK or England at the time or France will say, I want this territory to be mine, but the way that'll work is I just want the resources from it and I'll sort of set up a fake government or a puppet government in that place. So total war is not colonialism. Total war is where I want to defeat you, I want to take over. It can also be regime change, right? It can be regime change and it can be expansion. So total war, the United States in 2003 did engage in total war. We invaded Iraq, we got rid of that regime, and we forced a different system in place, right? We can call it democratization, whatever you call it, right? It is total war because the US took over that territory and forced a regime change. What we see more commonly is what's called limited war. Limited war is where you want to do something differently, right? This can be a lot of different types of limited war. It cannot be you trying to take over territory, but it can be certain things that you're trying to change. If you're trying to pressure a state leader, or you're trying to cause some sort of change in behavior, these can all be things that occur, right? Originally, when the US involves itself in Libya and sort of all these Northern African states, it wasn't to cause regime change, it was to force those leaders to stop committing genocide against their people. And we'll talk about genocide specifically later. There are also subnational types of war. Remember last lecture we talked about what it means to be subnational, right? Below the state level. So you have civil war and you have guerrilla war. Civil war is just any type of conflict where you have two factions and both factions want control over the territory, right? This can be our civil war in the United States, or the United US Civil War, where the South says, I want to just be my own section and I'm just leaving. Or this can be the Syrian civil war, where both groups are like, we want control over the state. Civil wars are very bloody, they're very violent, and because they're contained in one state, they're treated very differently. The international community typically doesn't involve in civil wars because that's one state's sort of solution to their problem, right? That's how they're resolving whatever differences they have. And I'm not saying that as a solution, as a positive, I'm just saying that's the way that they have to stop whatever practice they had and sort of rebuild their system. Often it leads to two states completely separating, right? There are states that no longer exist. Kosovo is a new state because of it from your text, right? South Sudan. A lot of times when you have a civil war, one of the outcomes is that you end up with two different states. Guerrilla war is very different. When we're talking about guerrilla war, we're talking about when you have no front line. Often what you will have is asymmetrical warfare. Asymmetrical warfare is where one side of this war is a very organized, very sort of set up and found and sort of highly funded military, right? An advanced military. The US is at that high level. They have the aircraft, they have the tanks, they have all the rules, and the soldiers are very well trained. And then on the other side, you have a group that doesn't have the training, doesn't have the technology, doesn't have the resources. And so what they will do is they will start taking up very different behavior. They will stop trying to hold the line, right? They don't want to hold territory. They will let the more advanced and larger military take that land, and then in another point they'll come out and attack and sort of just work on harassment, sort of dwindling their numbers, or just pure attrition, right? You're a larger military, but I'm just going to keep hitting you a little bit at a time, and I'm going to keep trying not to get caught in that fire, right? I'm going to hit you and then I'm going to run. And this guerrilla warfare becomes this practice that all smaller militaries take up, right? Even the United States during the War of Independence takes up this guerrilla warfare. They couldn't just stand in line and fight against the British troops, so they started taking up all of these tactics. All smaller militaries are going to have to engage in asymmetrical warfare. It's a very normal practice. The other part about guerrilla warfare is that you will often not be restricted by state borders. When you have a state military, they want to be within a specific border. But when you have a smaller group that doesn't have to be within that state, what they'll do is they'll cross border lines. And this is very problematic. If you are the United States and you are in one country and some sort of terror group or rebel group is crossing into the border of another state, you can't just invade that other state. That other state is sovereign. That other state has certain borders that exist. So these guerrilla groups, whether they be rebel groups or terrorist groups or whatever they are as non-state actors, or even if they are recognized as a state, by crossing those state borders, it creates a new sort of dynamic where you don't want to cross those borders. And because you don't want to cross those borders as a state military, you have to deal with this asymmetric warfare in a different way, and it creates a lot of problems. So after the shooting stops, we have to figure out what to do. And we will talk about this later. So I'm just going to go over a quick sort of few terms to get used to this. The first is disarmament, demobilization, and reintegration. So when a conflict ends, the first thing that you expect is that those individuals in the conflict, in an armed conflict, they're going to give up their weapons. Then they need to go home, right, where they came from, or if they can't go back to where they came, they have to find some home. And then the last part is reintegration, and reintegration is really, really difficult. How do I take someone whose training is about killing someone else or about war fighting or whatever it is that is violent, and how do I get them a job that's not violent, right? Because there just aren't that many jobs that are violent. So you need to get them back into society. And if you don't have a way to get them back into society to reintegrate them, that's just going to lead to a group that only has one skill set, violence, and doesn't really feel comfortable in that society, which means they'll return to violence more likely. So reintegration is a very difficult process. Because of this, a lot of conflicts end with what's called a Truth and Reconciliation Council. And so what a Truth and Reconciliation Council does is they try to get all of the things that happened out. Everyone explains what happened. And a lot of times what will happen is a person who was an assailant, someone who was violent and a violent actor, part of a rebel group, part of a state military, they will explain what they did in front of the victims or the victims' families. And they'll explain what they did. And the idea is that by getting all of it out, one, you don't have it come out later, right? You don't want it to come out later and sort of derail some sort of peace accord. The other thing is that it allows certain victims and their families to come to a point where they can have forgiveness. There is a idea by Bishop Desmond Tutu, right? This idea of I'm going to mispronounce this, but it's called Mbutu, right? It's this idea that you need to forgive those that committed violence against you. And one of the big arguments they make is that it's forgiveness, but not amnesia, right? That I'm going to forgive you. I'm not going to forget about what you did, but I'm going to forgive you, not for you, for me, so I can move on with my life, so I can sort of build this community. And if we forgive the sort of the violent actors for what they did on both sides, and we try to come back together, that's going to build a more sustainable peace. And we might talk about sustainable peace building later, but we're not going to talk about it today. Okay. In theories of war, we always want to concern ourselves with what's the unit of analysis. The individual level is the one that we're going to talk about most because it has all of the things that we consider the most often. Rational choice. Are you making a rational choice, right? Are you just saying that conflict is the best option? Is the best option to go to war? And we talked about the Fearon article, so we won't spend too much time on it, right? There's a way to decide whether it is the best idea to go to war. Then deviations of rationale, right? We talked about groupthink in the last lecture. But there are a lot of things here that can cause a problem. You can be in a situation in which you are getting misperceptions. And one of the ways you can get a misperception is what Tedger would call relative deprivation, where it looks like you're getting less than someone else, or it looks like your people are not getting access to certain resources. So those can be deviations because your perception is different from what is occurring, and because your perception is driving you to some sort of cognitive bias or shortcut, right? And you're not seeing that. The next part is a domestic level, right? Is your society more likely to be violent? And we're very dismissive today in IR about this, but there are a couple of things that we have seen in the past. One is that capitalism, right? This greed of capitalism. If you're a capitalist society, you're constantly looking for more, and because you're constantly looking for more, you're going to go out and take from others. This is an argument that sort of exists. It's not as big today. And then the other one is a shift in society, right? An industrial revolution often leads to a social revolution, right? Why do we have the Russian revolutions in the beginning of the 20th century? Why do we have the French Revolution, right? Some of these revolutions are directly tied because due to industry, because what happens is you go from a farming society, what we call an agriculture-based or an agrarian society, where the people that are in power own land, to an industrial society where the people in power, sometimes called the petty bourgeoisie, are the ones that owns the means of production, right? Who now owns the corporations? It doesn't matter if Rockefeller wasn't a landowner or if Bill Gates was a landowner. It's that they have these corporations, and these corporations today are the power centers. So you don't have to own a lot of land to be a very powerful figure after the Industrial Revolution. And because the power bases shift, you expect some sort of conflict. But the entire world has sort of already gone through this Industrial Revolution. Now we talk about places being developed enough, but there aren't really these dramatic shifts in what technology is available. There might be in the next 20 years, we might talk about that, but we won't talk about that today. The next is the interstate level. And in the interstate level, this is when we're talking about what does the anarchic system do? Are you not willing to fight, right? Are you risk averse because you say, oh, I've been building up my military, but I'm only doing it to defend myself, right? That's deterrence. I'm building a military to protect myself. Or does that bleed into an arms race? We're both building up our militaries, and because we're building up our militaries so much in this self-help system, that we're more likely to go to war, right? And this is the difference between the structure of the anarchic system and whether or not states have agency. And we talked about this when we talked about Alexander Wendt, right? If states have agency, then they're not gonna go to war as much because they're gonna say, yeah, it's a self-help system, but that doesn't mean I have to fight you. That just means I have to make sure I'm defended. And we don't have to get into an arms race. We can both decide to have a smaller military, or we can both decide to build weapons that are defensive rather than offensive. So this has a lot of weaknesses today because agency is a big factor for states due to Alexander Wendt's argument and other arguments coming out of this constructivist theory. The last part is this global level. It used to be a very common belief that there was a cycle of violence, that violence occurred cyclically, and we would go to war, and then we'd have a time of peace, and then we'd have a time of war. That ends, based on Fukuyama's argument, that the world has just changed too much. There's too much interconnectivity. It's too easy to interact with people, right? It used to be much harder, right? You might go to war because you couldn't have as much communication, or your citizens can more easily be convinced that the other group was villainous or inhuman. But you just can't do that today. It used to be very easy to see the Chinese in one light that the government wanted us to see us in because you didn't know or have access to the Chinese people. But now you can communicate with Chinese people on any day. And I don't mean people who are Chinese descent. I mean, you could go to China, you could fly to China right now. Also, you could just get on Skype, and if you wanted to learn Chinese or talk to someone who's Chinese or any other country, that's also possible, right? Technology makes this idea of cyclical violence much less likely, right? It pulls away from that. And the more that we're connected, right, not only is interdependence good in the economy to keep states from fighting, but the more that people are interconnected, the harder it is for them to dehumanize each other and go to war. So now we're going to talk about conflicts of ideas. Actually, we're going to come back to conflicts ideas. I'm going to split this into two parts just so I can have a better review process. So we're going to end now. This is part one. Make sure you watch part two as well.